Blog Talk Radio.
Mi chiamo Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit, Ineye EGUA DA, Medinde Ojirafo, Kwesi Radnehem Pata Akan. Akwamuma na Maruka Etibi Mu Ojirafo. That means greetings to all Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit people, meaning African black people. Today is EGUA DAY, Marketplace Day. My name is Ojirafo. Kwesi Radnehem Pata Akan. Ojirafo of the Akwamu Nation in North America. Yet I say we thank you once again for tuning in to the show. We are going to place some links in the chat room for the information that we're going to be going over tonight. We're going to look at the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the Ancestral Jurisdiction, as well as the Okom Economic Development link as well. And we're just going to put these in here right quick. If you are on the phone line, you have a question or a comment, you can hit the number 1 so we can see that your hand is raised. If you're interacting in the chat room, you must log in as a user in the chat room in order to interact in the chat room. If you don't have a username, you can sign up for one quickly in Blog Talk. All right, so first we're going to place the link directly to the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the Ancestral Jurisdiction. And you can download that quickly. Also, the Okom Economic Development page. And we also have that same, we'll put a link as well to the same page on Facebook also. We have the economic development, I'll call them economic development model page on our website, but we also have an, I'll call them economic development page on Facebook as well. So we're going to put that in the chat room also. And then we have to send out a quick link, a quick message, make sure that people knew that we were back on. For the individuals who are new to the broadcast, we do have 3 broadcasts on a weekly basis. We have the Akanfo Nanasong, Ancient Authentic Akan Ancestral Religion. We have that broadcast on Juada, which is Monday. And in that broadcast, we deal with the expression of Nanasong, Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit ancestral religion, the Akan expression. Number 1, because we are Akan, but number 2, because Akan culture, Akan spirituality, Akan ancestral religion, there is misinformation being propagated regarding Akan culture, spirituality, religion, cosmology, and so forth. Misinformation coming from individuals in the Western Hemisphere, and misinformation coming from individuals from the continent who have been infected by Christianity, infected by Islam, infected by other white pseudo-religions and pseudo-spiritualities, infected by white culture. And that infection has plagued some groups for over the past century or a couple of centuries. And therefore, they have woven these infection, misinformation, foolish philosophy into the practice of their traditional culture. So therefore, you see people who speak their traditional language, live in their traditional villages, dress in their traditional dress, eat their traditional foods, drum and sing and dance and engage in ritual practices that all appear to be traditional. However, because of the infection that took root a century plus in the past that has been passed on, some of these quote-unquote traditional practices and philosophies behind the nature of the Abosom, the divinities, the nature of the Nananung Nsamanfo, the spiritually cultivated ancestresses and ancestors, some of that information has been corrupted, infected. And so therefore, these individuals are passing off misinformation under the guise of Akan culture, Akan ancestral religion. So we talk about Akan for Nana Som, ancient authentic Akan ancestral religion. So we're purifying that process. We're purifying the actual cosmology. Just because people go through initiations or get PhDs or have spent a great deal of time on the continent or moved to the continent, or if they were born and raised on the continent and have never lived anywhere else outside of their ancestral village. If the infection had taken place within their blood circle, then the infection takes root. And if you do not consciously identify how you have been infected and then move to eliminate, eradicate those infections are passed on. And that is evident by the fact that the information in large measure that's being propagated from individuals on the continent as well as in the Western Hemisphere with regard to Akan philosophy, culture, ancestral religious practices, and so forth is misinformation that's infected. So this is why we deal with Akan from Nanasom, ancient authentic Akan ancestral religion on Jordan on Monday. On Finada, which is Tuesday, as well as Abinada, we deal with Ojira, which means purification. It means purification in the language of the Akan people. It also means purification in our ancient ancestral language of ancient Kanat, Nubian, ancient Kemet, ancient Egypt. Same term, same meaning. We deal with purification because we talk about Ojira or purification operationalizes Nanasom, operationalizes Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit, or African ancestral religion. Through purification, we engage the ritual incorporation of divine law and the ritual restoration of divine balance in a harmonious fashion. The essence of ancestral religion, Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit, ancestral religion, which we term Nanasom as a general term for ancestral religion, no matter what expression it takes, wherever black people are in the world, no matter what Afurakani or Afuraitkaitnit African ethnic group you come from, the ritual essence, the essence of ancestral religion is the ritual incorporation of divine law and the ritual restoration of divine balance. That means through ritual, we incorporate those things, objects, deeds, and entities we need to incorporate so that we may harmonize our thoughts, intentions, and actions with divine order. And through ritual, we reject those things, objects, deeds, and entities we need to reject in order to restore balance to our lives when imbalance has occurred. These are the expansive and contractive poles of ancestral religion, of Nanasom, the ritual incorporation of divine law and the ritual restoration of divine balance. It is the food and medicine of Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit people, as we talk about in the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the ancestral jurisdiction. This is what Nanasom, our ancestral religion, is. So, because we engage that process, we must engage that process in a purified fashion. This is why we say Ojira, or purification, operationalizes Nanasom, operationalizes ancestral religion. So this is what we deal with on Tuesday nights. We deal with ancestral religion in general, purifying and clarifying concepts, cosmology, the nature of the forces in nature, the nature of the divinities and their relationship to us, the nature of the ancestresses and ancestors, spiritually cultivated and otherwise, and their relationship to us, the nature of the Great Mother and the Great Father, the Supreme Being, and their relationship to us, the nature of the Creator and Creatress, who are grandchildren of the Supreme Being, and their relationship to us, the nature of the whites and their offspring, spirits of disorder, and their non-relationship to us. So we go into detail about clarifying various aspects of cosmology, culture, showing that ancestral religion impacts our every thought, intention, and action from moment to moment. Every aspect of our lives is impacted by ancestral religion. Because when we deal with ancestral religion, we're talking about harmonizing our thoughts, intentions, and actions with divine order. We're living in the world. The world is an orderly creation. Just like you have a physical body and your body is animated by your tsum-tsum, your spirit, the physical world, the planets, suns, moons, stars, the black substance of space, oceans, rivers, and so forth. These are physical aspects of creation, but they are animated by spiritual forces in creation. These are the abosom, as they're called in the Akan tradition, the Orisha, as they're called in Yoruba, and the Vodou, as they're called in Fon and Ebe culture, the Ntoru-Ntoru-Tu, as they're popularly called in ancient Kemet. These are the spirit forces in creation, the children of the supreme being, the forces in nature that embody divine order in creation, that regulate order in creation. When we deal with ancestral religion, we're talking about aligning our thoughts, intentions, and actions with divine order, meaning we are aligning with the forces in nature that undergird order in creation, that embody order in creation. So therefore, every thought, every intention, every action does not happen outside of creation. It happens within creation, and creation is governed by the forces in nature. So ancestral religion, in reality, governs every aspect of our lives, whether we acknowledge that or not. So this is what we deal with on Zinada Abinada Tuesday. Then, of course, on Wednesday, Abukuda or Akwada, we deal with EGUA marketplace. EGUA means marketplace in the Akan language. What we typically deal with is we have individuals come onto the show, talk about their businesses, organizations, institutions, Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit, or African businesses, organizations, institutions, how they are serving the community, and how they are transmitting their ancestral religious values through their service to the community, through their products, their services, their institutions, organizations, and so forth. So we've had a number of individuals come on, and we will have more individuals coming on. We also set aside this show for dealing with the philosophy behind approaching trade and commerce from an Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit ancestral religious perspective, from that morally grounded perspective rooted in our ancestral religious practice, rooted in our alignment with the forces in nature. And the forces in nature, as we said, are the embodiments of divine order. So therefore, when we align with them, we're aligning with order. That means that we engage trade and commerce and economic activity rooted in divine order, so we have an ethical foundation for our practice of trade and commerce. So we talk about the philosophy undergirding that on this show as well. In that vein, what we have launched, what we have initiated a number of weeks ago, and we are in week number 12 of this operation, is our Okom economic development model. And we place the link to that economic development model in the chat room, the Okom page on our website. Okom is an Akan term meaning hunger, but it also means possession. So we published an Okom economic development model, a manner in which we can engage economic activity within the Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit African community, black community, in a harmonious fashion, rooted in our ancestral values, showing how we, once we align with our ancestral values that are positive, inherited, ancestrally inherited values, then we can move forward in a unified fashion to engage in the kind of economic activity that will liberate us so we can establish some independence, establish our sovereignty, and defend that sovereignty. So we deal with that in the Okom economic development model. We publish that model. And part of that model, of course, is a strategy to affect what we're trying to achieve. And that strategy is to starve the beast and feed the pride. And what that means is that we make an assessment on a weekly basis. We make a determination about the kind of money that we would have potentially spent or wasted with the whites and their offspring. And instead of spending that money with the whites and their offspring, we starve the beast and feed the pride. We starve that white beast, take those funds away from that white business, and instead reallocate them towards the business of the week. We are targeting one Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit, or African black business per week for 52 weeks for capital infusion. We are in week number 12 of this operation. So we've had every week we've been supporting, asking the community to support a specific business, organization, or institution. And we have that list on our Okom Economic Development page, on our website, as well as on Facebook. So we're in week number 12. We ask everyone to starve the beast and feed the pride, starve the beast, the money that you would have spent at Starbucks, the money you would have spent at McDonald's, the money you would have spent, wasted at Walmart or at CVS or 7-Eleven or different stores where you're receiving products and or services that you really do not need, that you've wasted money on. Take that $5, take that $10, take that $15, starve that white beast and feed the pride, feed the business of the week. And of course, if 1,000 people took $15 away from the white snarl spring, starved that white beast, and reallocated it to the business of the week, then that particular business will receive a $15,000 infusion of capital directly from the Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit community. So therefore, instead of us giving $15,000 to white businesses, which we have been doing, we would have given that $15,000 to a black business. Therefore, they are able to sustain their businesses, keep them open, expand their businesses, hire people within the community so that they can serve us at a higher capacity, in a greater capacity, and employ themselves at the same time and support themselves and their families at the same time. So it's a win-win situation. And if we do not participate in that fashion, by default, we're simply supporting our absolute enemy. We're giving them our funds. They're expanding their businesses, keeping their businesses open, hiring their own relatives to keep them employed, send them to school and purchase homes and clothing and everything else. So if we do not engage in starving the beast and feeding the pride, then we're by default supporting our enemy. So we are in week number 12, the business of the week. Is What's in Your Womb, which is a book that has been published by Sister Ma'at Imma'al-Keru Amin. She came onto the show a while back, talked about her publication as well as the other work that she's doing in the community. They have a Ma'at Foundation. They also have the Head Ma'at Call, the Soul Psychic Fair, a number of different things, workshops that they deal with teaching. They also have natural foods, catering and so forth, holistic catering, a number of things that's going on with the sister and her husband. So she published the book, What's in Your Womb, dealing with womb wellness from an Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit perspective, physically, holistically, as well as, of course, spiritually. And we recommend that book to every Afuraitkaitnit woman and girl. What's in Your Womb. So when you go to the website, the Okom Economic Development website, you can get to her website link and you can make your donation. You can purchase the book. You can access the services from that business, starve the beast, and feed the pride. So that's the business of the week. And we are in week number 12, so it's been about close to 3 months. This is the 12th business on the list. The business list is ever growing. So we will have more individuals being added on a regular basis. We are targeting one business per week so that they can receive the optimal infusion of resources, of capital, so that they can expand, so that they can keep their businesses open, expand, hire, and serve our people in a greater capacity. Then we move to the next business of the week, and those previous businesses that receive such capital infusion, then they can participate in supporting the other businesses on the week as well. On the list as well. So this is what we're doing, and this is an ongoing process. 52 weeks, 52 businesses at least. We may even go further and begin to add more than 52 businesses as the list begins to increase. All right. So this is what we're doing on the Okom Economic Development front. And we just want to put a couple of links, make sure we have the links in the chat room. We're going to put the direct link to the book, KUKUU-TUNTUM, The Ancestral Jurisdiction, so that everyone can see that. If you have a question or a comment on the phone line, hit the number 1. And if you're in the chat room, you must log in as a user in order to interact in the chat room. And if you don't have a username, you can sign up for one quickly in Blog Talk, and you can interact in that fashion. All right, so we just want to make sure we didn't miss anything here. Just looking through, give me a second real quick. We had the broadcast last night. There were some individuals, I believe, that had a couple of questions. We were not able to get to everyone's question last night because we were kind of pressed for time. We had a great deal of information we were trying to get out before the end of the broadcast, before a cutoff. So we were only really able to take one or two calls. So if you have a question or a comment from the previous broadcast, you can ask those as well on the phone line or in the chat room. And if you have a comment about the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the ancestral jurisdiction, as well, you can comment about that as well. Because we've had a number of individuals who have, as we've mentioned in the promo for the show, we've had a number of individuals who talked about the impact that the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the ancestral jurisdiction, has had on their lives and the people who they're in connection with. So let's get into the information. And this is, in a sense, this is a special broadcast because this is the last broadcast of this week, of our broadcast week. We have 3 broadcasts per week: Joda, Sinada, Awukuda, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. So we won't be back on until next Joda, next Monday. But on April 25th, which is Meminida, which is Saturday, that is the 13th anniversary of the release of the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the ancestral jurisdiction. So this is, in a sense, a special broadcast. We wanted to highlight that marker. We want to highlight that occasion here because of the impact of the work. So what we did, we published the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the ancestral jurisdiction, in 13,002, so-called Gregorian calendar 2002. We initially published it as a 3-CD set. A few years later, in 13,006, we put the entire 3-CD set in the form of MP3 files on our website, and we made the entire 3-CD set a free download from the website. We eventually published the transcript of the entire 3-CD set in the form of a book. We have the ebook version. We also have the soft cover version. That is one of the 16 books that we have published to date. And we have ebook versions of all of our 16 books, as well as soft cover versions of all of our 16 books. And we published released the transcript, the 80-page book, which is the entire transcript, with additional information as well, supporting images of the deities we talk about from ancient Kemet are in the transcript, as well as certain Medusu hieroglyphs spelling out the names of the divinities that we reference in the text, as well as some other background information, supportive information. So we released that as well. And of course, the ebook version of the KUKUU-TUNTUM, just like the 3-CD set, the free download, both of them are free downloads. In fact, all 16 of our books are all free downloads from the website. And then the soft cover versions, we also publish ourselves in-house on our own printers and in color, and we sell those. They range between $8 and $11. But the ebook versions are free. So we first published it as a 3-CD set in 13,002. 13,006, we released the entire 3-CD set for free on the website. And then after that, we published the book, and the book is on the website as well. Now, the thing about the publication and what we want to highlight with regard to the publication, we've had a number of individuals over the years. It's been 13 years. Innumerable individuals have told us it's the most important work that they have studied. They've studied a number of different things, but the impact of the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the Ancestral Jurisdiction, they have stated is the most impactful with regard to everything else that they study. And we want to talk about the reason behind that and what the value of the work is and why the etymological had us put it out in the specific manner that we published it. So when you look at the text, when you look at the book, you can download the book. We talk about number one, it's groundbreaking in the sense that we were the first to publish the correct etymology of the names of the various fictional characters, including Jesus, Yeshua ben Pandera, Muhammad, Abraham, Isaac, Ishmael, Moses, Aaron, Solomon, Sheba, Menelik, Buddha, Allah, Yahweh, Brahmin, etc. All of these characters are fictional cartoon characters who never existed of any race or in any form whatsoever. So we've given the correct etymologies, the etymological origin of the names of these characters, as well as the actual divinity from whom these titles were taken from ancient Kemet. The titles of these divinities, forces in nature, their titles were taken, names as well as descriptive titles were taken by the white snare offspring once they invaded Kemet. Those names and titles of different divinities were corrupted and then applied to fictional white characters. And then those fictional white cartoon characters, after they were named, then different fragments of stories, different fragments of functions in nature that they stole from the divinity, the actual forces in nature, as they learned about them, because we, of course, had our ancestral religion in ancient Kemet, texts all over the walls and so forth. They took fragments from stories, fragments from functions of divinities in nature, and added them to these fictional white little characters that they were manufacturing. Then they began to promote these fictional cartoon characters as real. And through warfare and through hundreds of years, they finally forced a small percentage of the population to begin to embrace these fictional cartoon characters. This is what took place. So all of these characters are fictional. There are many writers who have attempted to prove, for example, that Jesus was a fictional character. But the etymologies they gave with regard to the nature of the fictional cartoon character have been inaccurate. We're the first to give the proper etymological origin of the name. Some of the other characters, some people have said, okay, they are fictional, but they had misinformation with regard to the etymological origin of the names, as well as the actual divinities whose functions were taken and corrupted and applied in a fragmentary fashion to these fictional white characters. So you have black scholars later on reading the work of misinformed white scholars and simply repeating the misinformation of white scholars. Many people, for example, have read the ancient Egypt, Light of the World, written by the Achiwadefo, the spirit of this order, the white writer, Gerald Massey, as well as the Natural Genesis and so forth. And they have taken that work, and when he talks about the origin, the names of many of these biblical characters, the vast majority of the etymologies he puts forward for the origins of the names of these characters in Kemet are inaccurate. He misinformed through that publication. Then you have black scholars, for example, he'll say Abraham is derived from the ancient words from Kemet, Ab-Rahim, or the desire of Ra, the creator, him to serve, the desire to serve Ra. And they'll say Abrahim means the desire to serve Ra. That is totally 100% inaccurate. No truth in it at all. And the same goes with the various etymologies of the various names that he gives. And once he gives these false etymologies, then the cosmology associated with these false etymologies he applies are also inaccurate. So then we have black scholars repeating this misinformation coming from this European. And then that information is spread. And many people have done that. They have either read black scholars who have repeated the misinformation of Gerald Massey and other white writers, or they have simply read these white writers themselves, these white authors themselves, and repeated the misinformation coming from these white authors. Some of these white authors, pseudo-historians, some of them pseudo-metaphysicians and so forth, and pseudo-occultists. So you have black people studying occult information, studying masonry, studying so-called Gnosticism, Hermeticism, and so forth, and they begin to repeat the misinformation of Hermeticism and Gnosticism, Kabbalism, and so forth, Sufism, whatever it is. And they're promoting this misinformation, this pseudo-metaphysical information, as though this is the ancient arcanum of ancient Kemet that was preserved in Europe until it was time for our people to come back and grasp this information. And it was preserved amongst a small cabal of people. Totally false, totally foolish, totally inaccurate. The white scenario spring did not preserve any ancient sciences of our culture. They did not do that, and they are not capable of doing that. The people of ancient Kanat, Nubia, and ancient Kemet, once the civilization began to deteriorate because of invasions and some of our people allowing certain invasions to take place, allowing some of these infiltrations to take place, allying with the weaker whites in their offspring to gang up against another black ethnicity because one black group was against another black group, civil war taking place, and some black people allying with the whites and offspring to defeat another black group who was stronger than them and so forth. Once those things began to happen, society began to fracture and deteriorate. Some of our people began to migrate away, migrate further south, migrate west, migrate into the central part of Afuraka, Afuraitkait, and so forth, some on north and east. So the same priests and priestesses, as well as elders, eldresses, so-called chiefs, chieftainesses, kings, queen mothers, and so forth, paramount kings, paramount queen mothers, migrating away, migrating to the west, taking the entire culture, of course, in their blood circle with them, and reestablishing that culture wherever they went. So the ancestral religious practices of ancient Kemet, you will find all across Afuraka, Afuraitkait, you will also find the same language. We speak the same derivative language. We practice the same ancestral religion. We practice the same culture. We worship and become possessed by the same deities, communicate with the same deities, engage in divinatory practice with the same divinities, with the same ancestresses and ancestors. Our culture was preserved in the blood circles of our own people wherever we migrated. And even when some of our people, after having migrated to west Afuraka, Afuraitkait, and central Afuraka, Afuraitkait, and residing in those areas for centuries, then some of us being caught up, snatched up because of civil war, we become prisoners of war and sold to the whites and their offspring, taken to the Western Hemisphere, we still carry the culture in our blood circles, and the culture manifests in the Western Hemisphere. So whether it is Vodou in Haiti, whether it is Lukumi, the Orisha tradition in Cuba, whether it is Candomblé in Brazil, whether it is Winti, the Akan tradition in Suriname, whether it's Obia, the Akan tradition in Jamaica, whether it is Kudu, the Akan tradition in North America, whether it is Juju, the Yoruba tradition in North America, whether it is Voodoo, the Fon and Ebe tradition in North America, wherever we have migrated to or been forced to migrate, we carry the same culture, carry the same ancestral religion, carry the same divinities in our blood circle, transcarnationally, through successive reincarnations, through Bebra, rebirth, reincarnation, and so forth. So all of the quote-unquote secrets, and we're not talking about secrets, the nonsense, mysteries, and all of that. It's really not mystery. Sacred ancestral wisdom and religious practice was carried in our blood circles, and these various traditions we just named are the direct expression of ancient Kanat and ancient Kemet. It has absolutely nothing to do with anything going on in Europe. Nothing to do with anything going on amongst Asians, whether it's in China or Japan or anywhere else, as well as Indo-Europeans throughout the so-called Near East, or into so-called, you know, India, Aryan India, and so forth. Wherever our people migrated, that's where the ancient ancestral religion migrated, because we carried it with us. When we migrate to the so-called Near East, we migrate into India, we migrate into North Central South America, the Caribbean, and so forth, through a direct migration or forced migration, it is through us that the culture is carried. It has nothing to do with the whites and our offspring. The whites and our offspring are incapable, racially, spiritually, of engaging our ancestral religious practices. They have no knowledge of that, because they are repelled by the forces of nature, just like cancerous cells, which they are. Cancerous cells are repelled by the immune system cells and destroyed. They don't incorporate themselves within the body and live, you know, in harmony with the body and so forth, and feed the same way the body does. When the body is working properly, the immune system destroys those cancerous cells and expels them. It repels them, rejects them, and they're never able to reintegrate into the body. The whites and their offspring are the cancerous cells in the body of black humanity, so when they manifest, if they seek to pray and project their perverse emanations to the forces in nature, those perverse emanations are repelled, just like a magnet repelling another magnet without it touching across the table. Any ritual prayer they engage in, ritual song, ritual dance, libation, offering, meditation, anything they engage in, any kind of projection they send forward, anything that exudes from them, energetic-wise, is repelled by the spirits of order, the Abosom, the Orisha, the Vodou, and so forth, as well as the Supreme Being, as well as the ancestresses and ancestors of Afuraka, Afuraitkait. So they can never know the divinities because they cannot communicate with them, because the divinities do not communicate with them. Of course, they do not possess them. They do not guide them at all. The whites and their offspring are spirits of disorder. They do not have an anchor within their spirit body, an anchor of divine order within their spirit body. We talked about this week the nature of the Ka and the Kayat, the soul, the divine consciousness, the divinity that dwells in the head region, that carries your specific function that you are to execute throughout the course of your life. That divinity that was assigned to dwell in your head region and guide you throughout the course of your life by the Supreme Being, Nyamewa, Nyameo, Aminet, and Amen. Only Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit people have a divinity dwelling in their head region that guides us throughout the course of our lives, that was assigned to us by the Supreme Being. The whites and their offspring are spirits without a ka, a kayat, a kra, a krawa, a soul, body without a brain. So they don't have an anchor in divine order. Therefore, they are not able to align with and communicate with all of the other spirits of order, which is all natural creation in creation. Plant life, animal life, mineral life, Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit people, as well as the forces of nature. So therefore, they cannot maintain any ancestral culture at all. When people talk about it was the Moors who brought the sacred sciences of ancient Kemet up into Europe, there were black people who were in a derogatory fashion labeled Moors by the whites in our offspring. We published our book, Moor Means Dead, where we have proven irrefutably that the term Moor means dead. We go into detail about that in the book and the accompanying video broadcast, where we go through the book in detail. Those who are called in derogatory fashion Moors by the whites and their offspring, and that title they began to utilize themselves, meaning dead or dead people, mentally dead, spiritually dead, and so forth, just like the term Negro. Some of our people embrace the idiocy of Islam. Once you embrace a pseudo-religious culture, you're rejecting divine order. No divinities are communicating with you when you're deliberate in your attempt to engage in pseudo-religion, simply meaning you're deliberately engaging in self-destructive, disordered thoughts, intentions, and actions on a consistent basis. If you seek out disorder, you make yourself repulsive to the spirits of order, the embodiments of divine order. So people who began to engage these pseudo-religious practices, that simply means they were rejecting the order of creation and embracing thoughts, intentions, and actions that serve lust and malice as opposed to divine law and divine hate. the two poles of divine order. So those individuals who engaged that, sure, they went up into Europe, they engaged in engineering and building and things like that, but that's not sacred science. Building, if somebody goes to the University of Michigan and learns architecture, they're not engaged in sacred science. If they learn something about botany because they observed what somebody told them and just imitated what they told them, that's not sacred science. If somebody teaches them about algebra or teaches them about geometry or teaches them about trigonometry or calculus, that is not sacred science. You wouldn't consider somebody with a bachelor's degree, a master's degree, or a PhD in engineering or physics or biology or psychology, you wouldn't consider them a master of sacred spiritual science. They're just engaged in lower level activity, which has no basis in spirituality at all. And our people knew how to build buildings. We were architects. We were engineers. We knew about medicine. We knew about these various things. And once we engage in pseudo-religious culture, embrace the perverse culture of the whites and their offspring, now we're engaged also in a secular approach, in the true sense, to building quote-unquote society. They were not civilizations. They were just society. We knew how to build, so when we moved into Southern Europe, we built schools and everything else. We had farmland. We dealt with medicine and so forth, but that's not sacred science. Sacred science has to do with our capacity to invoke the Abosom, invoke the Orisha, invoke the Vodou, get infused from them, the energy from them, and then utilize that energy to bring order to our existence, divine order to our existence, and receiving the guidance from the Nananun Nsamanfo, the spiritually cultivated ancestors and ancestors. If you cannot invoke the Abosom, the deities, and evoke the Nananon Nsamanfo, the spiritually cultivated ancestresses and ancestors of Afuraka, Afuraitkait, you are not engaged in spirituality. You're not engaged in quote-unquote spiritual sciences or anything sacred or quote-unquote esoteric. You're not engaged in anything. So what the brainwashed blacks would embrace pseudo-religion engaged in was secular civil engineering, secular learning, secular school, and so forth. And then when they engage in pseudo-spiritual practices, when you're embracing Islam or Christianity or Judaism or Hebrewism, pseudo-practices like that, of course there were no such thing as any ancient Hebrews. When you engage in those pseudo-spiritual practices, you're not dealing with any actual divinity. You're not dealing with the great mother and the great father. You're not dealing with the ancestresses and ancestors of Afuraka, Afuraitkait. The only kinds of spirits that you can deal with are those deceased, discarnate spirits who are criminal-type spirits or wayward, immature, ignorant, self-destructive, spiritually disordered individuals who made their transition, who are still earthbound, and then these individuals would engage in ritual practices, including divination, with these drunkard, wayward, criminal, ignorant, immature, deceased spirits. And then pass that off in the face of some other individuals as the communication with the divine, communication with the deity, and dealing with ancestral religion and so forth, which is really not. So that's all the brainwashed Moors could deal with spiritually. So they were dealing with secular civil engineering, which anybody can do that. That has nothing to do with anything sacred or spiritual. It's purely secular. No different than a beaver building a dam, a bird building a nest. We can build things. It has nothing to do with spirituality. So they dealt with civil engineering as well as other forms of quote-unquote nation building, totally dispossessed of anything spiritual or sacred. And then when they engaged in ritual practices, because they were engaged in perverse pseudo-religion, the only kind of ritual practices they could engage in was dealing with discarnate, wayward, criminal-type, disordered spirits, and sometimes trying to pass them off as dealing with actual divinity. So that's all that was going on. Brainwashed Negroes who erroneously refer to themselves as Moors and just following the path. They don't understand that reality because they're engaged in a pseudo-religion. Then, of course, you have the Negroes who are teachers of that foolish doctrine who do know that this is the reality, but they continue to lie because they are proxies for the whites and their offspring. agents of the white scenario spring in our community and have been that for over 100 years. So we just wanted to lay that out. There was no passing of the torch to the white scenario spring. That must be understood. So once we understand that we carried our culture with us, then we can reconnect with our ancestral culture because it's inherited, it's inborn, it's innate, it's intrinsic, it's ancestrally inherited, it's transmitted and carried with us transcarnationally. Now, when we get to the value of the KUKUU-TUNTUM and talk about its importance and its difference, we already talked about differences with regard to other publications. We already talked about the correct etymologies and the knowledge of who these divinities are. We were the first, for example, to publish not only the proper etymologies of the names of these different divinities, these different fake characters stolen from real divinities, including Jesus, Yeshua ben Pandira. Some people think Yeshua ben Pandira was the real Jesus, the historical Jesus, and the Jesus of, the sun god mythology is dealing with Heru, but Yeshua ben Pandira was the historical Jesus of the Talmud. We show the actual etymology of the name of that fictional cartoon character as well. We are the first to show the actual etymology and of the name Muhammad as Muhammad, a title of Hap, the divinity Hap, the spirit that animates the Nile River. He's called Hap-Met, or Hap of the North. And then there's Hap of the South, a twin divinity, two male divinities, Hap of the North and Hap of the South, the river flowing through the north of the country, the river flowing through the south of the country. Hap-Met is Hapi of the North. Mu is the term for water in ancient Kemet. When he's called Muhap or Muhapi or Muhap-Met, it's Mu, the waters of Hap-Met, the northern Nile. Muhammad was corrupted into Muhammad, and the whole cosmology surrounding Hapmet's or Muhammad's place in creation, the flooding of the river coming at the end, the yearly cycle, announcing the end of one cycle and the beginning of a brand new cycle. This is the quote-unquote, prophet coming at the end of the world, the last messenger of the fake deity Allah. One of his titles is Sadem. That is the title of the river as well. Sa means tear, a sanctuary, a shrine, a sanctuary of a divinity. Rem means teardrop, the divine teardrop falling from the eye of Ra. The star system called Sepatit, which the white scenario spring called Sirius, the brightest star in the sky. They called it Sirius, which means the scorcher, the seer, to burn Sirius, because it was the brightest star in the sky and it moved in position. The heliacal rising of Sirius at the beginning of the year, and that also announced the swelling of the river. And what people said was that there was a teardrop that fell from that great star, the brightest star in the sky, and that divine teardrop fell into the river, and that's why the river swole every year and then overran the banks for a few months. And then once the water receded, months later, then people could plant crops because there was new black silt, rich soil, deposited on the banks of the river, and people could plant their crops because it rarely ever rained in Kemet, so they were totally dependent on the flooding of the river. The river was therefore called Sa-Rem, the shrine or sanctuary, Sa, of the divine teardrop, Rem, Sa-Rem. So the river itself is Sa-Rem. It is the river water carries Sa-Rem, the sanctuary of the divine teardrop. So Muhammad, the water is Mu of the northern Nile divinity, Hapmet. Muhammad brings Sarem, and Sarem was corrupted into Salem, and Salem, and Islam. So Muhammad brings Islam at the end of the cycle, the last messenger at the end of the year, and the star moves into position at the end of one cycle and the beginning of a new cycle, and then the water overruns the bank, meaning Muhammad bringing Salem, or Muhammad bringing Salem, or Islam, overruns the country. That whole cosmology, we are the first to prove that irrefutably and conclusively in the KUKUU-TUNTUM. Until we publish that information, black people assume that there was a Muhammad. Some were foolishly beginning to move in the direction, claiming that Muhammad was black and therefore you know, this is one of our people and Islam is black and all this other nonsense. We prove Muhammad never existed at all, white or black. Muhammad is the spirit that animates the river right now. He is a divinity, a force in nature, and he exists in the various cultures around the continent. Bilal is also a fictional cartoon character, a corruption of a title of Set, the divinity Set, who governs the desert, the red land, the desert land as well as the red clay land and so forth. Bar-Ur, a title of Set, becomes Baal-Ul and Balul and later Bilal in Arabic. This is why Bilal is called the Ethiopian Set, the divinity of the south in Ethiopia. He was burned in the hot desert sands for quote-unquote Allah. This is talking about the Ethiopian divinity being the god of the desert, the messenger of Allah, the muezzin or the caller of the faithful. Set was the messenger of Ra. After the contendings of Heru and Set, Heru is adjudged to be the rightful heir to the throne of Al-Sar. He is placed on the throne by the divinities, and Ra declares that Set will come to sit up in the boat of Ra and become the one who thunders for Ra, speaks for Ra. He becomes the messenger. Set operates through the planet Mercury. The Mercury, therefore, sits in the boat of the sun, meaning the planet Mercury sits right next to the sun and is the messenger of the sun, of the Aten. He's the spirit that animates the planet Mercury. He's the messenger. He's also the so-called trickster. He's also the god of the desert, the red land. And, of course, he's the same in the Yoruba tradition. He is Eshu, Legba, the trickster, the messenger, and so forth. And then he's the same in our Akan culture, Awuku, Nana Awuku, Akweku Anansi. He's the messenger. He operates through the planet Mercury. He's also the trickster, and he also governs the desert. But he's called Set in ancient Kemet, but also a title Bar-Ur. Bar-Ur, there was no letter L in ancient Kemet. There was a rolling R, so Bar-Ur becomes Baal-Ul, or Balul, or Bilal. And later in Arabic, this is the same divinity that they corrupted the title and added to a fictional cartoon character. They wanted to make black people embrace the fake religion, so they stick a fake character, a black character, and then we would say, okay, well, we want to embrace this religion. It was, you know, he was the caller of the faithful. He was right next to the praying being. He was the messenger of Allah. Allah is a corruption of Ra-Ur. Ra-Ur means Ra, the great one. Ur meaning great. Ra-Ur or Ur, Ra, the great one. Ra becomes Ur-Ra or Ulla in Arabic. That is a corruption of a title of Ra. So for Bar-Ur becoming the messenger of Allah, or Ra-Ur or Ur-Ra, that is just becomes Bilal, becoming the messenger or the caller of faithful to Allah. So that whole thing we lay out in the KUKUU-TUNTUM, in the book, in the publication. The same thing dealing with Moses and Aaron and Abraham and Isaac and Ishmael and Solomon and Sheba and Menelik, Jesus, Yeshua ben Pandira, all these different characters. So when we laid that information out, no black scholar, no white scholar had this information, these correct etymologies for these various characters. And most importantly, the cosmology that undergirds the names of these characters, cosmology in ancient Kemet, of where these deities fit in the created order. And once you see where they fit in the created order and what their names mean and what their descriptive titles mean, then you can see where the whites and offsprings took a title, slightly corrupted it, or sometimes just used the same title without even changing it at all, and then added it to a fictional white character, took a portion of the function of a certain divinity, like they took a portion of Muhammad's function in creation, his role in cosmology, his role in the world, his role in the created universe, took a function of that, and add it to the little fictional white character, Muhammad. And then you get a whole story, a life story of Muhammad from a specific fragment of the cosmology of this divinity in creation. Then they carnalize this fake image, place him in a specific region in the so-called Middle East, in Saudi Arabia and so forth, and make him a real character and make people believe he actually existed, which he never did. So once you understand the cosmology that undergirds these names, these divinities who function in creation, then you can never be fooled by these. The whites and offspring are absolute enemies. Of course, they know that these characters are fictional because they created these characters. So they're not going to reveal that, hey, we created these characters. They're going to act as though they're real, and they're going to publish thousands and thousands and thousands of books going into the detail of Muhammad's life or Abraham's life or Ishmael's life and Isaac's life and the life of Jesus and all these fictional characters, pretending as though these characters are real, even though they all know they are absolutely false. They simply want to brainwash our people. So we have the real information, and we were the first to publish that. That is a significant piece with regard to the KUKUU-TUNTUM. We also talk about, and again, once people study that information, just from listening to the KUKUU-TUNTUM one time, we've had numerous individuals who were once Christians, some of them ministers, people who were involved in Islam, some of them imams, people who were involved in Hebrewism, people who were involved in Moorish pseudoscience, shaking the Moorish science temple and so forth, have left all of that nonsense alone simply through one listen to the KUKUU-TUNTUM because we break down this information in detail. Now, and nobody can pull them back into that nonsense because they have real information. The next piece we want to talk about is restoring the consciousness of the divine balance of male and female. And that's one of the key pieces that we start off with regard to the origin, the beginning of the work. We first talk about Ra and Ra'et, the creator and creatress, two halves of a whole, creating the universe together. Many people talk about Ra, you have these white writers talking about Ra, and then the black researchers simply imitate and mimic the white writers, and they talk about Ra, the creator, Ra did this, Ra did that. But Ra'et is a force in creation. She is the creatress. She has always been. So that points to the fact that our people are really not paying attention. You don't understand the ancestral religion by simply reading things that the whites and their offspring wrote, and then you write it in your own words, or you go to the continent, you go to ancient Kemet, you take down and take note of various texts, then you translate them based on the methods of the whites and their offspring, tweak it a little bit with an Afrocentric flair, but then you're still teaching the same false cosmology. And this is what you have many so-called scholars doing. They will talk about, they write the Medu Netcher and they read the Medu Netcher and they teach the Medu Netcher and so forth. But when you look at what they're teaching with regard to cosmology, they have no understanding because they still have the same white mindset. All they've done is blackened up what the whites and their offspring have done. Now, it's important, of course, for our people to understand that the culture is ours and these were black people. That's key. But that's as far as they have gone with regard to accuracy. Once they get beyond that and they begin to attempt to interpret the data because they still have a white mindset, they misinterpret the data because they don't understand cosmology. And you will not understand cosmology unless you deal with the forces in nature that actually give birth to the cosmology. At the end of the day, we were engaged in ancestral religion. We were not engaged in some silly notion of anthropomorphizing aspects of nature and then creating stories and calling them gods and goddesses just so we can understand nature better. That is pure stupidity. When you have Negroes repeating that nonsense, that's because they've been colonized by the whites and their offspring mentally and spiritually. When you actually engage ritually with these divinities and they possess you and communicate with you through ritual practice, through divination and so forth, men, women, and children, then you know who these divinities are. You have direct experience with them. You have facility with them. Then you can speak directly as to how they function and how they manifest through these cosmologies because you're living the culture. You're not just aping what the whites and offspring said and blackening up misinformation. So because we engage that process, we're informed by the Nsamapa, we can not only get that information, show it tangibly, but give a proper analysis about what's taking place. So when we talk about Ra and Ra'et, it's because we deal with Ra and Ra'et. When we talk about Amin and Aminet, it's because we deal with Amin and Aminet. When we talk about Ka and Ka'et, it's because we deal with these forces in nature. And they exist throughout the continent and wherever Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit people are. And as long as we're not colonized mentally and spiritually, then we can attune to these forces in nature and our ancestresses and ancestors and be informed by them. And then they will direct us to physical evidence, textual evidence of the information that they guide us to spiritually. And therefore, we can show that textual evidence in detail to any of our people and publish it. Then our people can go and take that textual evidence and scrutinize it themselves and verify it themselves. And this is what our people have done over the past 13 years with the KUKUU-TUNTUM. So we talk about Ra and Ra'et, Amin and Aminet, the foundational relationship of creation that undergirds all of creation, is the balance of male and female. Amin and Aminet have always been. There's never been a time when there was just Aminet, the great mother. There's never been a time when there was just Amin, the great father. There's always been Amin and Aminet, and they work together as a unit to give birth to creation. And this is the reason why we must work together as a unit, male and female as complementary opposites, in order to give birth to children. Because it's a reflection of that foundational relationship that undergirds all of creation. We bring that consciousness back through the KUKUU-TUNTUM. When we were talking about Amin, Aminet, Amin, Ra, and Aminet, Ra'et, many people had never heard of Aminet or Aminet Ra'et before. Even people who claim to be engaged in Kemet-ik practices and Kemet-ik priesthoods and so forth, they would talk about Amen, they would talk about Ra and some other divinity, but you would never hear them enunciate the name Aminet or know at all who Ra'et is and what her place in cosmology is. Have you ever invoked Ra'et? They have no knowledge of that whatsoever. They just talk about Ra because they're not really dealing with these divinities. We also talk about Ma'a and Ma'at. People talk about and pontificate about Ma'at for just exceedingly, profusely, Ma'at, Ma'at, Ma'at. And they demonstrate the fact that they really don't know who Ma'at is. First of all, she's a force in creation. She's not just a principle. She's a divinity that we communicate directly with. She exists, of course, in all Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit culture. She's called Oma, Me in our Kan culture. She's called the Orisha, Odu in the Yoruba tradition. She's not just the codification of divine law. She's an Orisha, and they recognize her as an Orisha. She's called Gbadu, Gbadu in Vodun, G-B-A-D-U. Gbadu is Odu. This is the same female force in creation, the codification of divine law. And she's Amame in Akan. So everybody knows who this force in nature is and they communicate with her. But then there's the divinity Ma'al, the male force of divine law and balance. This is not new information in reality. The reason our people skip over Ma'al and only focus on Ma'at is because the whites and their offspring skip over Ma'at and only focus on Ma'at. It's not that he hasn't been around or he's some brand new divinity. He's been around all along. And even those who have textual references, if they have the, for example, the Egyptian hieroglyphic dictionary, two-volume set that everybody who claims to teach things about ancient Kemet has, you will see the divinity Ma'at in that dictionary. If you claim to study the book Shat Emduak, or the Book of the Underworld, you'll find the divinity Ma'al, his image, as well as his name spelled out right next to him in the 11th hour of the night, in the Shat Emduak, or the book of that which is in the Duak, or the spirit realm of the underworld. Why would you skip over him and only focus on Ma'at? Because the whites and their offspring skip over him and typically only focus on what they want to focus on. They will focus on Ma'at, schools, and laws, but not as a divinity. Then, on the other hand, they focus mainly on male divinities, and sometimes they'll say, oh, well, Amen is the great father, but, oh, they would always stick a little wife to some of these divinities. And they're not really divinities. They just gave a little female name, a little female suffix to the name of the male god, just to pair them up, just to make it seem balanced. But they didn't really have a function in the society. That was just something that was added. And then our people repeat that idiocy. But when you actually invoke Ma'a and Ma'at, you know who these male and female forces are. And when you align yourself with them on a daily basis, and they guide you on a daily basis, you know who they are. So we brought that information out in the KUKUU-TUNTUM 13 years ago. We just recently did a broadcast on the nature of the divinity Ma'a, the male divinity, and his relationship to the goddess Ma'at. And we proved who he is, not only in ancient Kemet, but also in the Akan tradition, Yoruba tradition, and Vodun as well. And you can get that broadcast on, you know, in the archives as well as on our YouTube. So we show the divine balance of male and female in the KUKUU-TUNTUM. And that permeates the entire work, and it begins to restore that consciousness within our people. If you talk about, well, I'm Kemetic, and of course, ik is a European suffix, linguistic suffix that's not part of the language of ancient Kemet. So something of Kemet would be Kemeti, but Kemetic is not part of it. When people say I'm Kemetic, I'm involved in Kemetic culture, and I worship Amen, and Amen and Ra is the same divinity, then you know people don't know what they're talking about. Amen is a divinity. Ra is a grandson of Amen. The father of Ra is Nu, and the father of Nu is Amen. So Ra is the grandson. Ra'et is the granddaughter of Amen and Amenet. So if you don't know who they are, you'll listen to the White Snow Spring and say that Amen and Ra and Ptah, they're all just different names for the same force, and they're just descriptive titles. Pure foolishness. So we bring the knowledge of who these divinities actually are. Then we actually go into the origin of the term Afuraka, Afuraitkait, and we're the first to publish the actual etymological origin of that term, first in the KUKUU-TUNTUM, and then we published a separate book, which of course is on our website. You can order Afuraka, Afuraitkait, the origin of the term Africa. You can download the free ebook version in its entirety directly from our website. You can also order the soft cover version if you would like. And that the soft cover version is $10. So we prove the etymological origin and the cosmological origin of the term Africa. The White Snow Spring, of course, will try to promote the idea that it comes from the Romans, the Greeks, from Sanskrit, from Phoenician language, all these different groups. In reality, we show the origins of these various pseudo-etymologies. And they say it means Afrika, meaning the sunny land in Latin. We show that that's not accurate. In fact, Pre is a title, a corruption of a title of Ra. Pa, Ra becomes Para, and later in Coptic becomes Pre, and this is where the Romans got Pre, Ka, Ka meaning land, Pre, Ka, the sunny land. It's a title of Ra operating through the sun. And they talk about Afrik, meaning not cold in Greek, meaning the hot land. That does not come from the Greek language. Afri means to boil, vapor, hot vapor, smoke, and so forth in the language of ancient Kemet. This is where you get the not cold portion of the hot land from. When they say in the Phoenician language, Farika means the land of fruit, the land of produce, the fertile land, and so forth. Farika or Parika can be found in the language of Kemet, produce, grains of any kind. Parika, later Farika, in Phoenician, it's the exact same term. So it's not even a Phoenician term. The Greek term is not a Greek term. It comes from ancient Kemet. What they call the Latin term Afrika, it actually comes from ancient Kemet. The term Apara in Sanskrit, meaning the land which comes after, because it's west of India, so they say that was in the west. Afuraka, Afuraka is west of India, so it's the land that comes after India. Apara, Aparaka, the land ka that comes Apara after. Well, Peta in ancient Kemet means that which comes after, posterity, progeny. That is not a Sanskrit term. So every single etymology, as well as term meaning separation or subtraction, parak or farak in so-called Phoenician as well as Arabic and so forth, we show that the term para also means to separate, subtraction, escape, division, and so forth in the language of ancient Kemet. And then Afrikia, meaning queen of heaven, we show that's the corruption of the title of Afurait amongst the Berbers as well as people of ancient Kemet, where the Arabs got that from. So every one of those etymologies from Greek, Latin, Sanskrit, Phoenician, Arabic, these various so-called etymologies from these quote-unquote languages, none of those terms come from any of those languages. All of them are corruptions from Perm in Kemet. So we show the actual Medusa, the actual hieroglyphs of all of those terms in the language of Kemet to show that we had those terms first, and then those other languages, they passed on into those other languages when the whites and their offspring learned those terms from us and included them and kept them in their language. Then we go and prove that the term Afuraka, Afuraitkait, is the origin of the term Africa, and we show it in the Medusu, referencing the first landmass that rose up in primordial times from under the surface of the water to be the first raised land of earth. In the papyrus of Ani, in the papyrus of Kunefer, in the temple of Aset in Paraka. In fact, on the front cover of the book, we show the actual Medusu hieroglyphs from the papyrus of Kunefer and the temple of Aset in Paraka, spelling out Afraka as well as Afraka, different variations of the term, delineating that reality. So we were the first and the only to prove that Afuraka, Afuraitkai comes directly from our ancient language, and it designates the land itself, the Ka, the Kaya, the high land to which Afura and Afurayat, the creator and creatress, operate at the beginning of creation. Then we also show the same term in the Akan language with the same cosmology. So we were the first to prove that. And when we show that, it ties directly to our identity. Now we have a proper understanding of our identity. Some people refuse to use the term African because they think it came from the Greeks or came from the Romans, some other nonsense. We also show the, in the book, we show the origin of the term Al-Kabulan, which is actually not an ancient term. It's an Arabic term. It's a corruption. So it's not an ancient term for the continent. And we show the etymological origin of Al-Kabulan and where it came from, which nobody has done. When Dr. Ben talked about Al-Kabulan being the origin, the ancient name of the continent, what he was quoting was an excerpt from Leo Afurakani. And we showed that in the book. And Leo Afurakani was writing about 500 years ago, was speculating about the origin of the name of the continent. He put forth many of these false etymologies. He talked about the Arabians and the Ethiopians using the term Al-Kabulan, that is an Arabic term. El-Gebelain means between the two mountains. In Arabic, Gebelain. And El Gebelain, between the two mountains, that becomes Al-Kabulan. And we prove that in the book Afuraka, Afuraitkait, the origin of the term Africa. So we have all of that information laid out in the book, but we introduce that as well in the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the Ancestral Jurisdiction. So when people understand where the term actually comes from, what it actually means, Ka meaning raised land, the first land, the high land, the first land to exist on earth, rising up from under the surface of the water. But Ka, as well as Kaet, the female version, also means soul, the divine consciousness that we talked about earlier, the divinity that dwells in the head region of black people. Ra is the creator, Ra-et is the creatress. Afu means flesh, but it also means house or place of residence, because your flesh is the house or place of residence of your spirit. Ra is the great spirit, the divine living energy in creation. Ra'et is the female great spirit, the divine living energy in creation. Ra and Ra'et, the divine living energy, moving through the Ka, is the union of the divine spirit. Ra and Ra'et, the great Ba or Ba'etic creation, the great divine living energy in creation, the union of the great spirit and the soul, Ka and Ka'et. So Afu means flesh, Ra is the great spirit, Ka is the soul. Afu means flesh. Ra'et is the female great spirit. Ka'et is the soul, feminine. So Afuraka, Afuraitkait gives us our physical, spiritual, and soul identity and lays it out perfectly, cosmologically, and also identifies the specific landmass through which Afuraitkait moved in the beginning of creation. So we were the first to bring that out and firmly establish our identity cosmologically, etymologically, and spiritually in that term. Some people saw Afuraka, and they recognized that must have been the origin of the term, but they assumed that Ka simply meant soul or spirit. It does mean that, but with regard to the landmass, what they didn't understand is that Ka is a title not only of any kind of landmass, but specifically a raised land, a highland, a mountain, a highland. And the first raised land was the land that was raised up above the surface of the water. In the beginning, the entire earth was covered with water, as we talk about in the cosmology. Ra and Ra'at caused a portion of the ocean floor to rise up and break through the surface of the water. That's the first raised land. That is Ka, male, and Kaet, the female name. So that's the significance of the term Ka and Kaet with regard to location, with regard to geography. The first Ka, raised land. Kaet, raised land. The primordial mound, as it's called in the various cosmologies. They talk about the highland that's now within Kimenu, the raised land, the primordial mound, the sacred mound. It's called Ka or Kaka, sometimes Keka as well. And then you find in the Yoruba tradition the first raised land, the Oke, is the land upon which the Orisha first descended to create the world. In the Akan tradition, Kaka means raised land. That's the same Kaka in ancient Kemet. And in the Akan tradition, amongst the Asiniye clan, they talk about when Odomankoma, which is Atim Kepra, finished creation, the people, we came up out of the ground and we established our capital and called it Afuni Kaka. And it's the same terminology, talking about the first landmass where the first people dwelled at the beginning of creation. We have all of that information in the book. So we proved that, which no other people did. We established our identity as Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit people. So yes, Ka and Kaet means soul, divine consciousness, but with regard to the geography and the landmass and our homeland and the first landmass of Earth, Ka means a raised land, Kaet means a raised land, and that is critical to the cosmology. We were the first to bring that out. So these are different things that have to do with the foundation of creation. We also deal with the nature of the abosom, the forces in nature and their relationship to us, the nature of the ancestresses and ancestors and their relationship to us, the nature of plant life, animal life, mineral life, and their relationship to us, the nature of the nature spirits and their relationship to us, the origin of the whites and their offspring, rooted in incest and dissexuality, homosexuality. Their spiritual perversion causes them to lose their ka, kaet, and they become spirits of disorder who have a spiritual defect which manifests as a physical degeneration, that lack of pigmentation and so forth. So we go into detail about that and the differences between us and them, the whites and their offspring, incarnated spirits of disorder, white Europeans, white Asians, white Hindus, white Arabs, white pseudo-Native Americans, white Hispanics, non-black people, non-Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit people are the whites and their offspring. They are spirits of disorder. They incarnate that way. We talk about the difference between divine law, which of course is love as well, the same word, the same concept, divine law being an expression of divine order. We talk about the difference between order, non-order, which are complementary opposites. You have non-order like clay, that is not ordered into anything, and then you have order. You shape the clay or order it into a sculpture. It went from non-order to order. That's a complementary opposite, complementary balance. The unformed to the form, the uncreated to the created. The black substance of space is unformed. It's a substance. It's a divinity, Ka and Kaet. Portions of that black substance were formed, carved out by Ra and Ra'at, formed into the black bodies, which would become stars and later planets and so forth. So the black substance, that plasma went from being unformed to formed. that complement, complementary, balance. When somebody comes along and you have formed something from unformed to formed, and then they destroy the thing that you have formed, that is a perversion of that which has been formed. Creation went from non-order, a non-ordered state, like the clay, to an ordered state. That was the balance. When somebody comes with a hammer and breaks up the pot you just formed, the vessel you just formed, now that is disorder. That is a perversion of the order. It is not a balance of the order. The balance is the unformed clay to the formed clay. The broken up clay is not the balance. It's the perversion of the formed clay. And when we understand that difference, which is critical to our cosmology and our culture and the way we live our lives, that we understand that this order is not part of the created order. It was not sanctioned to come into being by Inyamewa, Inyameo, Amenet, Amen. So when you have disorder, that is a perversion of the created order. This is why we have an immune system that stamps out disorder when it shows up, because it's not natural. It has a temporal existence. When you have spirits of disorder, the whites and their offspring, they're not naturally created. They were not sanctioned to come into being. Because of their own behavior, they made themselves repulsive to the forces in nature. Now they're cancerous cells, and they are slated for destruction. They have a temporal existence. So disordered individuals or entities are not natural, so they are to be stamped out. When you understand that they're not part of the naturally created order, then you recognize they are slated for destruction. You don't seek to incorporate them into your life. You don't seek to turn the other cheek. You don't seek to say, well, they're good and evil are two halves of a whole, and we can't reject them because then we're rejecting half of creation and all this other nonsense. That's pure stupidity. And that comes from brainwashed Negroes who follow the whites in their offspring, who know it's false, but they teach that information anyway. And some of these Negroes who think they're being metaphysical and spiritual and dealing with the Kabbalah and so forth, thinking that they understand the balance of complementary opposites, and they'll say male balances out female and heat and fire, and then they'll throw in good and evil, which is idiotic. Good and order is the same concept. So when you have non-order and then it goes to order, everything that's ordered in creation is the same as good. So something went from non-order to order. It also means it went from non-order to good. Everything that's formed by the Supreme Being is good or natural or real or harmonious. When somebody comes and breaks up the pot that you formed, now that's disorder. That is a perversion of the order, meaning a perversion of the good. Not a balance of the good, but a perversion of the good. That is what evil is, a perversion of the good, not the balance of the good. So we stamp out evil, we stamp out disorder, we stamp out the purveyors of disorder. So you don't seek to include the whites and their offspring cosmologically in the scheme of creation, the continuum of divine balance. You recognize their spirits of disorder. They are separated from the created order, and therefore they can be exterminated. Once you understand that, then you're on track with divine order. You understand divine law or love and divine hate, the two expansive and contractive poles of divine order. Creation comes into being via divine law, the expression of order, and it is sustained through divine hate, the impression of order. And we go into detail about that, but then we also have our book, Maranechi, Divine Law, Love, and Divine Hate, where we lay that out in detail. So these are the critical aspects of the peace. And the final major aspect of the peace is revolution and resolution. Two halves of a whole. The expansive pole of intelligence or wisdom is revolution. The contractive pole of wisdom or intelligence is resolution. When you understand that revolution and resolution are two halves of a divine whole and are governed by male and female forces in creation, the governor of the pole, expansive pole of wisdom, is Tehuti. The governess of the contractive pole of divine wisdom is Seshat. They govern revolution and resolution. When you have wisdom, when you want to apply wisdom to something, if you have an issue, you're trying to solve a problem, the first thing you do is you go back. You return to that source of omniscience. All of the wisdom, all of the knowledge in creation is in the consciousness of the Supreme Being. So you delve into that well of consciousness, that reservoir of consciousness, that is revolution. Re means back or again, volve means to turn, so to turn back, to go back, revolve, revolution. When the earth moves around the sun and returns to its point of origin, it is made a complete revolution. It is return back, return, revolution. And then when you have, once you have extracted what you needed from the consciousness of Amen and Amenet through revolution, then you use what you have extracted to bring a solution to the problem, to solve the problem, to bring a resolution, to unravel the knot, to unravel the disorder. That is resolution. So you engage in revolution so that you can affect resolution, problem solving. These are the expansive and contractive poles of wisdom, revolution and resolution, and they're governed by divinity. When you understand the spiritual foundation of revolution and resolution, and you also understand that the spirits of disorder are outside of the created order, and therefore they are slated for extermination, not to be embraced, but to be eradicated. When you have those two pillars of understanding, revolution and resolution are two halves of the whole of divine wisdom, and disorder is a perversion of the created order and is slated for destruction, then we can move forward as a community to establish our sovereignty and defend our sovereignty completely and effectively and perpetually. So these are the things that separate the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the ancestral jurisdiction, from the other work addressing these various issues in a misinformed fashion. We deal with them in depth from an ancestral religious foundation. And this is why individuals have said continuously that this is the most impactful work that they have experienced. So we're going to take some calls. See, we have some calls on the line. Okay, Michiowo on the phone line, number 4719. You have a question or a comment?
Yeah, I had a quick question. Carmen is doing Dr. Ben's promoting the original name of mother called Ethiopia Blank. Can you elaborate on that again briefly?
Hold on 1 second. You sounded kind of muffled. Could you say it again?
I said, you had commented on how Dr. Ben says in many of his books about Akibulan being the original name of the mother continent. Can you comment on that briefly again?
Okay. And it was still a little muffled, but it sounded like you were saying, commenting on Akibulan. Is that what you were saying?
Hmm? Yes, exactly.
When people have read about, most people, when they heard the term Al-Kabulan, they read it through the work of Dr. Ben-Yahya. Now, there were some people, because they were looking around for that term, and they began to investigate, and they couldn't find the term. And we've heard many people who are researchers, some have come forward and said, well, he made that term up because we've looked all around for it, and we can't find that term Al-Kabulan. I've heard a number of people say that over the years. In reality, they just didn't do research. If you look in the work of Leo Africanu, by the way, when they talk about Scipio Africanu is the origin of the name African, Africa and so forth, of course, we destroyed that whole ridiculous myth in our book, Afuraka, Afuraka, the origin of the term Africa. We proved that Scipio Africanu didn't have that last name until he actually invaded the continent. His name was Publius Cornelius Scipio. His father's name was Publius Cornelius Scipio. His grandfather's name was Lucius Cornelius Scipio. And his great-grandfather's name was Lucius Cornelius Scipio Barbatus. So once he invaded North Afuraka, Afuraitkait, and won a battle, then he became Publius Cornelius Scipio Africanus, the one who conquered this region of Afuraka, Afuraitkait. His brother's name was Lucius Cornelius Scipio, and when his brother invaded Asia, then he took on the last name Asiaticus, because he won a war in Asia. So he became known as Scipio Asiaticus, and his brother became known as Scipio Africanus. It's not because one named the continent Africa and one named the continent Asia. We show on one of our broadcasts, of course, and through the book, the origin of the term Asia from ancient Kemet. Sikhs become Sia and Asiad Asia, which is a term from ancient Kemet, dealing with the land, dealing with that which is projected out, talk like excrement and so forth. And you look at the determinative symbols for Sikh, that which is projected, dealing with excrement. And they're looking at Asia as a region of excrement and so forth. Sikh or Sia becoming Asia and Asia and so forth. But then you also have, of course, we talk about the term Afuraka, Afuraitkait. So Scipio Africanus had nothing to do with the naming of the continent, and we prove that in the book. But Scipio Africanus, living a couple thousand years ago, is a different individual from the individual called Leo Africanus. Leo Africanus lived about 500 years ago, and he was traveling through the continent, and then he wrote a history called A History of Africa, and he was speculating on the origin of the name Africa. He put forth the idea that maybe it came from the Greek Afrik, or maybe it came from Afer, meaning black in Latin, and maybe it came from, you know, these different titles. But then he also says in his book 500 years ago that the Arabians and Ethiopians, and of course at this time he's dealing with the Ethiopians speaking a corrupted so-called Semitic language, the Arabians and Ethiopians utilizing the term Al-Kabulam, and he spells Al-Kabulam with an M, Al-Kabulam, L-A-M, for the name of the continent. So, of course, obviously, Dr. Ben did not make the name up. People just did not do the research. He didn't just come up with this on his own. He was studying these books. And all you have to do is you can download Leo Africanus's History of Africa, and you can find that very quickly. What we did was, not only did we find that and put that information out there to show where the name actually came from, but we also show the etymological origin of the name Al-Kabulan in the book, showing it's an Arabic title, an Arabic corruption. Gebelain means between the two mountains. Al-Gebelain is where that comes from. Then becomes Al-Kabulan, and we also go into detail showing, well, why were they talking about between the two mountains? What does that have to do with anything? How does it become corrupted into that? Did the Arabs just come up with the title Gebelain? Where did the corruption come from? So when you have the divinity Kebu in ancient Kemet, he is the divinity, a wind divinity, the north wind divinity in ancient Kemet. He's a ram-headed divinity of the north wind. You see him with the wings and the ram head, flat horn ram. He looks just like Afura with the flat horn, ram head, and so forth. When the sun would set in the culture of ancient Kemet, Atem is the divinity who sits within inside the red setting sun. So when you look, for example, in the so-called papyrus of Ani, you will see Atem sitting in the boat of the red setting sun. And then when the sun sets on the horizon in the Western Hemisphere, you'll see Atem setting. And sometimes when you look in the Western Hemisphere when the sun is setting, you'll see the sun takes on a reddish hue, a reddish tint. And that's why they show him inside of that. But then the texts say once the sun sets, Atem sets in the setting sun, then he sends the cool north wind to refresh the people. The north wind divinity is Kebu. And Kebu looks, in the iconography, looks similar to Afura. And what the whites in the Arab Spring did was they combined and conflated these two ram-headed divinities that were associated with the sun in some aspects. They knew Afura is operating through the sun in the underworld. Kebu, the flat horn ram divinity, it comes after the setting of the sun and is sent by Atem. So Kebu is a portion of that term. Kebudan becomes Al-Kebulan. This is where what we're dealing with. This is why the White Narrow Frame will say that Afrika is the wind divinity in Latin, the southwest wind divinity in Latin, and they'll say this is where the term Africa comes from. It comes from Africa, the southwest wind divinity in Latin. Of course, that's totally inaccurate, because the southwest wind with regard to Rome was actually the northern wind coming from Afuraka, Afuraitkait. What was southwest of Rome was north in Kemet. The north wind divinity in Kemet, Kebu, is the southwest wind divinity from the perspective and the vantage point geographically of Rome. So Africa, if you know, they're talking about the African or African wind divinity. There was no such thing as any indigenous Roman divinity. So some fools would try to say that was an indigenous Roman divinity. There was no such thing as an indigenous Roman divinity. They learned about the forces in nature from our people. They didn't have anything indigenous. So what we do is we show all of that cosmology in the book, Afuraka, Afuraitkait, The Origin of the Term Africa. That's in part three of the book, where we go into detail about Al-Kebulan and El-Gebelan and all of that information. All right. So we have another call on the phone line, number 0776. You had a question or a comment on the phone line?
Mikiyama.
Majero, so heads up.
Hi, I just wanted to ask you a question about what you had mentioned earlier when you was speaking about Awuku and Set, and I think you said in Yoruba it would have been Isu, and then you had mentioned something about another origin of a different name of the same deity, but it was like Belal or Belaul. I'm not sure how you pronounce that.
Right. So when you look at the deity, Set. Go ahead. You got another question?
No, that was it. I just wanted to know, like, the origin of that, like, where did that origin of that terminology for Set, like where you said Balur, where did that come from?
Okay, so when you look at Set, so the reason why they have Belal, and they'll spell it different ways, but the root, of course, is B-L and A-L or U-L or E-L and so forth, Belal. The reason why they have that in these so-called Semitic languages, the term al or el or ul, you'll find that throughout so-called Semitic languages, whether it's ul or el or al, at the end of titles like Israel or angel or Michael and all these different things, and in Arabic, il or al or ul, you'll find it in ancient Sumer, you'll find it in, you know, the so-called Akkadian Empire, you find it in Arabia, you find it in all across the board in the so-called Semitic languages. That Ul title comes directly from ancient Kemet, the title Ur. There was no letter L in ancient Kemet, it was a rolling R. So Ur, meaning the great. The same Ur or Ura becomes Oura in Akan, referencing a honorific title, male, and Awura is a female, so you have Awura, Awur in Akan, it's the same Ur in ancient Kemet, meaning the great, and Ura, or Uri, the female version. So you, for example, you have Amin Ur, meaning Amin the great, or Heru Ur, Heru the great one, Ra Ur, Ra the great one. You have Ur Hekau, which is a title of a female divinity, the great one. Also a title used for Offset as well as Nebethet, meaning the great one of words of power, spiritual sound vibration, ritual prayer, and so forth, incantation. So that title Ur is where you get Ul and El and all throughout the so-called Semitic languages. So when Set, the divinity Set, is called in the so-called Semitic languages and cultures, it's one of his major titles is Baal or Bel. Sometimes they'll spell it B-E-L or B-A-A-L, but it's Baal. When is written in the Medutu of ancient Kemet. Of course, they don't have the letter L. They have a rolling R. So instead of B-A-A-L or B-A-L, it's B-A-R, Baal, Baal, with a rolling R. So Baar is Baal in so-called Semitic languages. They show, when they spell his name in that fashion, they show the determinative of the set animal with the two triangular-type ears and the straight tail sticking up and so forth, the aardvark-looking animal. So that's Baal. Sometimes he's called Baar Ur, meaning Baar the Great, Bar Ur. Bar Ur became Baal Ul and Bilal by the time, you know, the Arabs get a hold of him. This is why Bilal is the muezzin or the caller of the faithful, the messenger, because Set becomes the messenger of Ra. Baal or Baal is Ethiopian because Set is in the south, and he's ruling in the south, as well as the desert lands to the south and west of Kemet, associated with the Nubians, quote-unquote Ethiopians, and so forth. Bilal is burned in the hot sands of the desert because of his, you know, faith, quote-unquote, in Allah. He's associated with the hot sands of the desert, the Ethiopian individual messenger connected to the hot sands of the desert because Set is the divinity associated with the desert lands of Ethiopia, Nubia. He's the god of the desert. He's the messenger, the communicator of Ra, and so forth. So that whole identity of that fictional cartoon character comes directly from a title of Set.
You made that very, very clear for me, Madase.
Okay, Yeni Alfeda, we appreciate the call. Okay, we have another phone call. Okay, Michiawo on the phone line number 5096. You got a question or a comment?
Yes, I have a question, Michiawo. Yesterday, you were speaking on some glyphs, hieroglyphics, and I think you had mentioned one about bulge glyphs. Is it budge? B-U-G-E, is it?
Okay.
Can you hear me? Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. I wanted to know, is there like a controversy with that, is what I've been told. It's a controversy with that. And another question is, what is the, is that the same as metaneuter hieroglyphics, or are they not the same, and is there a controversy as far as the bulge?
Okay, so what we were mentioning, what happened was a caller asked, or somebody posted in the chat room, where can they find a publication that has the transliteration of the glyph as well as the translation, not just an English translation, meaning sometimes, for example, you get somebody wants a copy of the Papyrus of Ani, the so-called Book of the Dead. Then they go get a book, and it's just an English translation. So you don't have any reference point. You don't know if they translated anything correctly. You don't see the glyphs or anything. They just write the English translation. Or they'll have the images of the glyphs, like a, you know, just a photo on one page, and then on the facing page, you'll just have a full English translation. So they were saying, what about a different kind of translation? Budge is an author. Ernest E.A. Wallace Budge is an author, was writing, you know, at the end of the previous century, in so-called 1800s and early 1900s, published the Hieroglyphic Dictionary, 2-volume set, and a number of books and so forth, you know, dealing with the Medusa, the hieroglyphs, and everything else. The reason why we mentioned that particular version of the text is simply because the way it's laid out. So instead of just putting an English translation, you'll put a line of the glyphs, and right up under the line of the glyphs, you'll put the translation into the language, and then right up under that line, the third line, you have the English translation, glyph by glyph. So that way you can see the glyph, then you can see a translation, then you can see the English, a transliteration, then you can see an English translation. But you can also look for where he made mistakes as well. At least you have a one-to-one correspondence between the glyphs and the actual transliteration, as opposed to just having a photograph of some glyphs on one page and a paragraph of translations on the other page, and you're not mashing up the words with the glyphs. And some things, of course, he got wrong, and some things he got correct. What we recommend that people do is get a publication, for example, Let the Ancestors Speak, published by Ankh Mira, the brother who published the study of the language, a very, you know, thorough book on learning to read and write. And sometimes they'll call it the Medu Netcher. It's Medu Ntoro, but people often say Medu Netcher, the language of the hieroglyphs and so forth. This is a brother. He's made his transition. He's an ancestor now. He made his transition a few years back, but he wrote a very good book, Let the Ancestors Speak by Ankh Mira. That is like a manual you can learn to read and write the glyphs and so forth. Dr. Raketi Amin has published work on how to read and write the Medu Netra, the Medu Ntoro, the hieroglyphs and so forth. So you can learn these things from Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit author, and then you can make those corrections. More importantly, just as importantly, not only would you get books from authors that of our people, but looking at the languages of contemporary Afuraka, Afuraitkait, to clarify not only the terms and their meaning and the cosmology that undergirds them, but also the vocalization. So we can use the Akan language, for example, as a control to determine proper vocalization, valid vocalization, as well as the cosmological foundation for what these terms actually mean, beyond just saying any meaning I in the Akan language, any meaning I in ancient Kemet. We learned the vocalization because we still speak the term today. So we know it's not oni or imi. We can say it's any, because that's a valid vocalization, because we say any in Akan and it's A-N-I, and then you look at ancient Kemet, the glyphs for A-N-I is any, and it means I in ancient Kemet. So we can prove these different things by the languages on the continent today, whether it's Akan or Akango or Yoruba or Ewe or different languages, we can do that. So first we get books written by authors, Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit people who are working on reading and writing the language and publishing so that our people can learn in that fashion. Also studying the languages of contemporary Afuraka, Afuraitkait to have a fuller understanding of what's actually being spoken, how it's being spoken, how it's being vocalized, and the actual living culture that still exists, because we live the same ancient culture. And then when you do that, in comparison with works that are written by Budge and other white authors, you can clear up the misinformation when they have made mistakes in their translation. So that's what we were dealing with last night.
Okay, so metanator is different from the Budge. Budge is, there are two different things there, two different types of
Medu in ancient Kemet just means words, and Netra or Ntoro, really Ntoro means deity. So Medu Netra or Medu Ntoro means the words of the divinity, the divine words, the divine language. That's what Medu Netra or Medu Ntoro means. Ernest Alfred Wallace Budge is just an author. He was an Egyptologist, and he published a lot of different work, you know, translating glyphs and everything else. So when people say, hey, did you get that from Budge? They're talking about the author, Ernest Alfred Wallace Budge, who wrote these different books. And since he has a number of different books out, and they're very, very popular and very accessible in bookstores as well as online for free, many people, when they first began studying, they will get his books because they were very accessible. And they'll say, well, I got Budge's Volume 1 and 2 of the Hieroglyphic Dictionary, or I got Budge's translation of the Pirates of Ani, or I got Budge's Osiris and the Egyptian Resurrection, or I got Budge's book on the mummy, or Budge's book on how to read and write the hieroglyphs and so forth. So that's what they're talking about.
I understand that he's an author, but I was just trying to see, is it metanator that he's using? is it still considered the divine word of the word of the divinities? You know, like the metanemic.
Yeah, he got, you know, they were there gathering these papyri and so forth, and once they got them in the museum, and he was in the, you know, a keeper of the Assyrian antiquities and Oriental antiquities and Egyptian antiquities in the British Museum or whatever. So he would sit down, and him and his translators would sit down with these actual papyri and begin to translate. So they had them in their hand, and they're still in the museums today. So they had them. They began to try to translate them. Some things they got correct, and some things they did.
So is the Akan language, is metaneutered also? Is it from metaneuter? Is it its own language, Akan? Is it considered metaneuter?
Akan, as well as the various, like when they talk about the Niger-Congo languages, or hundreds of millions of people on the continent speak some Niger-Congo languages, whether it's Akan or Yoruba or Ewe or Bakongo or... these various languages all across the continent, all of them are directly descendant of the parent language of ancient Kemet going back tens of thousands of years ago. So that's like the parent language, the proto-language, and all of our languages come out of that. They're all expressions of that, and that's why we find the same terms with the same meaning, the same names of deities, and all of that. They're all descendant from that ancient proto-language.
And so it's like Akan is considered the same as the ancient language.
Right. It's just derived from the ancient language. Of course, certain things would change when we move, and certain idioms we include, or we may reverse the subjects and predicates, or the, you know, pronouns and things like that. But fundamentally, it's the same language. It comes from that same parent. And this is why we can use the Akan language as well as others. Yoruba, Ewe, Bakongo, various others, to gain, you know, insight into the ancient glyphs and everything, because we're speaking these same terms. We're using the same terms. We're using the same names of deities. We're using the same terms. So now there may be a difference, like if someone says, I'm going to the store, and then somebody else says, to the store I go, and they reverse, and their whole language is based on a reversal of the, you know, that structure. And you'll see some shifts like that in different languages on the continent, depending on the people, or sometimes the way they use pronouns and things like that are slightly different, but the root language is, you know, the same term.
I do. And so Akan uses budge and metaneter? I don't know.
No, you said, to the Akan, you say it again?
Akan uses the budge form and the metaneuter. Akan is used with the bud.
What we're saying is the metaneuter is just simply the language of ancient Kemet. So if you, anytime you see the hieroglyphs, that just means the divine writing. So the way the language was written down in these pictorial hieroglyphs, that's the pictorial hieroglyph, that's the quote unquote metaneuter of the divine script. So that's just a way to, just like we use the alphabet, metuneter or medutentoro is like saying alphabet, but instead of saying alphabet, we say the divine, you know, symbol, because they came from Tehuti and Seshat. So we don't just say alphabet, we would say the divine sacred symbol that reflects the language that we were speaking. So that's all that is. So, but the language itself, I mean, we were speaking the language, of course, before we started writing it down. So the same language we've been speaking even before we started writing it down, the Akan, and as well as these other languages, are directly descended from that parent language. Now, we started writing down our language. We started using symbols to represent sounds, vowels, consonants, and everything else. And we called those symbols divine symbols because we got the symbols directly from the Tehuti and Seshat when they were possessed during ritual and show us how to write down symbols that would represent sound. The Akan people don't use a alphabetical script per se. They do use Adinkra symbols. We have Adinkra symbols. We do also have Mbramu, which are quote-unquote gold weight, but they're also encoded symbols, and when you look at those symbols, the Adinkra symbol, as well as the symbols on the Mbramu, the gold weight, you'll find that those symbols can be found in the Medu and Toro as well. But we utilize them as teaching tools as well as talismanic. They have talismanic uses as well, but we don't use them as necessarily as a script per se.
And then yesterday you were saying something about being victimized by the European, the disorders, spiritual disorder. I found out about Shango. What is Shango? Is that like a priest to be Shango, or is that a language, or what does Shango mean? Do you know?
Okay. So, and let me say before I say that, answer, it's 10:56, so for the, if you want to listen to the rest of the broadcast beyond 11 o'clock, there are about 3.5 minutes left online, and after 11 o'clock, the only people that will be able to continue to hear the rest of the broadcast are the people who are on the phone line. So if you would like to listen beyond 11 o'clock and you're listening online, you can call in, and you have to call in within the next 3 minutes, because if you don't, you won't be able to hear. So the call-in number is 657-383-0635, 657-383-0635. The individuals who won't be able to stay on, remember that this is the 12th week of the Okom Economic Development Model operation, where we are supporting one business per week for 52 weeks. This is week number 12, the business of the week. This is What's in Your Womb, which is a book published by Ma'at in Ma'akeru Amen. She came onto the show, talked about her book, as well as her Ma'at Foundation and the Ted Ma'akal, the Soul Psychic Fair, and the different things that they're dealing with in their organization. We recommend that book to everyone. Please support her business. When you go to the Okom Economic Development page on our website, ojidafo.com, you can get to her link directly to our website, Starve the Beast and Feed the Pride. Take the funds that you would have wasted with the White Snare Offspring. Take that $5, $10, and so forth, make a donation to her website, access her products and services so that we can support an Afurakani Afuraitkaitnit business on a regular basis. So What's in Your Womb is the business of the week. And for those who, if you have benefited from the KUKUU-TUNTUM, the Ancestral Jurisdiction, and our other works, if you would like to support the work that we are doing, and we're also raising funds as well for to establish a permanent headquarters for the center, where we'll be having classes, including live streaming classes for those who can't participate in this region in the Washington, D.C. area, as well as employment opportunities and so forth with regards to publishing. We're working to establish that center. If you would like to support that work, if you would like to purchase some of our books, or if you'd like to make a donation, you can go to our website, ojidafo.com. Slash Nhoma, the Nhoma or publications page on the website. You can purchase any one of our 16 books, purchase of 10 books or more. It's automatically 30% off. Like, for example, some people have purchased the first 10 of our 16 books. Instead of paying $96, that's $66 for 10 books, is 30% off. So any order of 10 books or more is 30% off. Anybody who is forming a study group, and you'll see that on the website as well. You get the books for 30% off as well. And if you make a donation, if you'd like to make a donation, any donation of $15 or more, we will send you one or more of our books anyway. Just let us know which book you would like. So you can do all of that on the publications page of the website. Okay. And again, you have a few seconds to call in, 657-383-0635. Okay. So you were asking about Shango. Now, there is a language called Shango, but typically when people are talking about Shango in the Yoruba tradition, the Yoruba people of southwestern Nigeria, one of the largest ethnic groups on the continent, and because they're one of the largest ethnic groups in the western part of the continent, many of our people who were enslaved in the western hemisphere actually are Yoruba people who were snatched up from there and forced into the western hemisphere, so that's why it's very popular over here in the Western Hemisphere, because many of us are directly Yoruba, just like many of us are Akan and Igbo and everything else. Shango is one of the deities in the Yoruba tradition. Shango is the force of nature, that patron divinity of king, rulers, thunder and lightning. He is the master of the drum and so forth. He is Heru in ancient Kemet. He is Shango in the Yoruba tradition of the same divinity. He's called Soro, as well as Yao in the Akan tradition. He's called Hevioso in Vodun. It's the same divinity.
Okay, Vodun, yeah. That's the favorite thing, the Vodun. And it's, is it like a level of a priest, like a certain level that you reach as being a Shango?
No, he's a force in nature that's operating right now, operating through thunder, lightning, also connected to the sun and so forth. People can be a priest or a priestess of Shango if that's the divinity that governs them. That divinity possesses them during ritual and communicates to the community through that individual. They can be a priest or priestess of Shango, just like they can be a priest or priestess of one of the other deities, Orisha. Whoever governs their head, whatever spirit that governs the person, they will communicate with that person throughout the course of their lives, sometimes through spirit possession. Divinity governs that person's head, and they have that function to be a servant of the people as a vessel for one of the forces of nature. If Shango governs their head, then they can be a priest or a priestess of Shango.
Okay, and one quick question. Is there like an order of these energies, these spirits, like a certain order they should be in, like, and Pooh should be a certain way, Tahuti should be, should they go in a certain line, like who's first, second, third, and fourth, like that?
Well, they're in families. So when you look at the cosmology, so for example, when you look at some of our broadcasts, when we talked about the Septepi, the creation of the world, and we talked about the different account, cosmological creation accounts in the different centers in ancient Kemet, and we showed how all of them were dealing with different stages of the unfolding of the creation process. And we started off talking about Amen and Amenet and Kain Kaet and Hehu and Hehud and Nun and Nunet, and they talk about them being the primordial eighth divinities, so-called Agdawad. Those are the primordial divinities. And then next you're dealing with Ra and Ra-Et, the creator and creatress. And then you're dealing with Atem and Atemet, and then Ptah and Sekhmet. So they're in families. And as you look through these creation accounts, there is a hierarchy based on these families, from the primordial divinities coming closer to the fashioning of the world, and then these spirits taking up residence in the different geographical regions and geological features of the world. So when you look at those families like Ptah, Sekhmet, and Nefertim, there's a triad. You have Osar, Osset, and Heru, Amen, Nut, and Kentu. When you look at the different creation accounts, and you can go back and listen to those broadcasts talking about the different creation accounts, but those families of divinities, just like you have families of organs in your body, like you have the circulatory system, it's a system, the heart, you know, the veins and so forth. Then you have the respiratory system. You have the diffuse neuroendocrine system, the system of the ductless gland. They're like a little quote-unquote family. So all the different systems you have, they have their own organs and glands associated with them. In the same fashion in ancient Kemet, you'll see different groups of divinities. They'll say the eight divinities of Kimenu, the Agdawad, the sacred eight primordial divinities. Then in Anu, or so-called Heliopolis, you see the nine, or they call them the Ennead, the nine divinities, and it's a grouping of divinities, or the 42 assessors of Ma'at, or the four sons of Heru, and all of this. Just like you have different groupings of organs in your body that have their own function, there are different groupings of divinities that regulate the functions in creation. But when you look at the parent of divinity, like Nu is the parent of Ra and so forth, when you look at these creation accounts, they actually lay out the hierarchy. So when you read about Atem and Shu and Tefnut and Geb and Nut and Osar, Osset, Set and Nebethet, they lay out the entire hierarchy of who's the eldest, who's the father, who's the children, and so forth, in those creation accounts. So they lay that out.
Okay, and this is, and this, isn't it that when you were speaking yesterday, you said we can be victimized, as, you know, hearing a song that we don't like in our head, and that we can get controlled by. Isn't it also true that some of these people who they can learn these energies, and they could be working for the media, and they're using them against us, you know, using them against our people, black people, you know what I'm saying?
Yes, now that's a good question. With regard to these forces in creation, the whites and our offspring have absolutely no capacity to work with them at all. It's impossible for them to work with forces in divine order, but they can work with, you know, wayward, deceased entities as well as their own perverse desires, and they use the media to project their own perverse values and so forth to, you know, brainwash our people, to program our people.
Yeah, I mean, they can use us. They can use people. I didn't want to bring up anything commercial, but, like, say, for instance, Jay-Z, you know what I mean? They can take people like that, and if they learn these things that we're talking about here, can they use those things against us as a people? Like you were saying yesterday, they can take those, victimize us with the same way we're trying to use it for the right things. They can use it for the wrong, you know what I mean?
Well, what they can do is they can misinform on these things. Just to make a clarification so everybody understands, they can talk about, you know, ancient Kemet, and they can talk about gods and goddesses, and they can run all this information down, but that's just, they'll just be misinforming people about things. But that's different than us actually invoking the forces in nature and communicating directly with them. The whites and offspring can't communicate with any forces in nature. And the thing is, there are a lot of black people out here who are promoting the idea, some of these groups, some of these so-called Moorish groups and metaphysical groups, they're promoting the idea that the whites and offspring got their hands on our sacred sciences, and now they're using our sacred sciences against us, and they're using the energy of the deities against us. And that's totally false, because no deity ever communicates with them, doesn't possess them, doesn't assist them in any fashion. They could sit around and do rituals to deities all day long, and no deity will ever assist them in anything. So all they can do is misinform people about culture and about deities and about energy and so forth. And if they engage in any ritual practice with any disembodied spirit, it's always the spirit of some criminal, disordered individual that they work with to try to influence the minds of our people. So that's all they can do. All they can do is misinform and work with some criminal, wayward, disordered entity. But they can never work with the actual forces in nature.
So they can't. They can take one of us who can communicate with the forces and use us against. You know what I mean?
They can't do that, because if one of us, like say somebody who's a black person who's, you know, naturally connected to the forces of nature, of course, and they engage in ritual practice and so forth. If one of the whites in their offspring said, hey, I'll pay you some money, can you utilize the energy you have to, you know, brainwash the population, because I, as a white person, I don't have any access to that. If we move forward and say yes and try to do that, then the Abosom will separate themselves from us, and they will not participate in any kind of disorder. So they don't the forces of nature are not entities that simply obey human beings. They only obey Nyamewa, Nyame, Amenet, Amen, the Supreme Being. They don't serve us. We serve them. We're cells within the organs. The organs don't obey the cells. The cells obey the organs. So if we started to engage in misbehavior because we're following the whites and offspring criminals, and they're trying to get us to use our energy against the black population, the deities automatically withdraw from us. And then the only kind of spirits we have at that point, if we're engaged in criminality, is the same kind of weak, criminal, disordered, deceased individuals. That's the only kind of energy we can use, because no deity will lend their energy or support to any kind of criminal activity or any support of the whites and offspring.
So that dispels that. Okay, great. Thank you for clearing that up, because, you know, people say that a lot, that they can take the energies and use them in a negative way as if they have. So, thank you, Madate.
Okay, yeah, I'll say that. We appreciate the call. Yeah, so you'll find that amongst these, you know, people who think that they're involved in metaphysics or Moorish nonsense or the Kabbalah or Sufism or pseudo-Asian practices and Taoism and pseudo-spirituality, thinking they're involved in something esoteric, talking about the occult and the energies, and they have no knowledge of what they're talking about. They'll throw little terms around, and they'll throw little terms around about the Orisha and the Vodou and talking about that they've dealt with them and they're pouring libation and yelling out names of Greek gods and all this other foolishness because they don't know what they're talking about. And internally, you know it's something wrong with it because these fools are engaged in all kinds of nonsense, and they're running around giving speeches and having long presentations, 5-6 hours long, misinforming people about cosmology and mythology and bringing in Greek mythology and all this other stuff and trying to say, well, it's all the same and it's all the occult and it's all the dark side and all. They have no knowledge of what they're talking about because it's not all the same. So, again, the whites and offspring have no capacity to deal with any force in nature ever. Of course, there's no such thing as any extraterrestrials and all that other nonsense. The deities are not our servants and we're the real gods and the deities are supposed to be serving us and we're making a mistake if we think we're supposed to be serving the deities. Idiots who talk that kind of nonsense, you have a lot of idiots running around talking that nonsense, whether they call themselves practicing Vodou or esoteric sciences or the occult, they have no knowledge of what they're talking about. Totally misinformed. The deities do not obey us. We do worship the divinity. We are cells within the great divine body as a supreme being. We are cells within organs. Your heart cells, there are millions of them. They're not sitting around talking to each other, talking about, well, the heart obeys me. I'm the God, and the heart is going to obey me. We don't serve the heart. That's idiotic. When you're dealing with people like that, these are individuals who have low self-esteem, as we talked about before. They feel inadequate. They feel inferior. They feel powerless. So they want to say something to make themselves feel good. So if they say, I am the God, I am the real being, and all of the forces in nature serve me, and I can tell them what to do. And we're the God, we're the goddesses. That, you know, to an ignorant person, that sounds powerful. That makes them feel good to say, I'm a God, I'm a goddess, because it's covering over, papering over, glossing over the fact that they feel inferior, because they really bought into the idiocy of the white offspring and black inferiority, even though they won't admit it. They have to say things like, we're the God, we're the goddess. Even though internally they know that's stupid. They know it's not true. But they keep saying it externally to make themselves feel good and those around them to make them feel good. But internally, they know it's totally 100% inaccurate. So now there's a disconnect. You have people who are emotionally unstable, mentally unstable, as we talked about last night, spiritually discordant. Okra has disengaged from them. And now they're engaged in all kinds of foolish behaviors, and they will take the little twisted intellect that they have and their capacity to articulate and regurgitate things that they've read with charisma and misinform people with their ability to articulate misinformation in a charismatic fashion, all rooted in the fact that they feel inferior, and they want to cover up that inferiority by claiming that they're the deities and they're in control of the forces in nature. People are mentally ill. We have a lot of mentally ill individuals in our community, some with temporary or dime, as we talked about, temporary insanity, and some with permanent or dime with the okra, while the soul, the divine consciousness, is totally detached and separated for good. This is where you get that misinformation from. And because they're dealing with the wayward, discarnate, deceased relatives and non-relatives who are also feeding them and reinforcing this misinformation, then they feel empowered to continue to promote that misinformation, even though internally they know it's inaccurate. But since these little discarnate spirits are doing little spiritual things for them, little lower-level nonsense-type things, and they feed them misinformation because they were liars when they were on Earth, and now that they're deceased, they're still liars, so they're still lying to the people. And then they assist these ignorant people to continue to lie. So this is where they get this nonsense about the Moors kept the sciences and took the sciences into Europe, and the occult sciences are in the hands of Europeans, and they can utilize these sciences against us, and all this other foolishness that's coming from Negroes who have no knowledge of culture, cosmology, or ritual practice, or no facility with the actual Abosom at all. Okay. And they still worship the whites and offspring, bottom line. Okay, we have one more call on the phone line. Michiawo, on the phone line, you had a question or comment?
Mijama, my question, in regards to institution, I find, well, the challenging things I find with people, even when they ask me, and I dialogue briefly on this, is they looked at most of our people right now here in the continent are trying to set up their own form of institution in regards to better our people in their situations today. Particularly, I think, Omar Adele Johnson, when he's trying to get his institution for the boys and girls to be what he considered African-centered people, to train them to be African-centric, and et cetera. And I told them about your institution, and they kind of still don't know much about you or, you know, everything you do. So the one thing to briefly ask is what separates the institute that you're trying to form now than what these other guys or women, Afurakani or Afurakani, male, females, try and do at this stage, in regards better the minds of the youth.
Okay, so, and there are different kinds of institutions. So, for example, there are many schools, whether it's preschools or schools going from K to 12 or K to, you know, 8 or even some K to 6 or whatever. There are many Afuraitkaitnit, Afuraitkait independent institutions all over the country. There are many people who have formed those institutions. You have a number of them in D.C. and Virginia and Maryland and Chicago and New York and Pennsylvania and Ohio and Texas and a number of different institutions. So people are starting institutions all the time, just regular schools. Whether it's a school for boys, a school for girls, a co-ed school, or different kinds of schools, some people are starting those. Some people have homeschool networks. Those are the kinds of institutions that they're starting, and there many of those, more of them are cropping up in our communities on a regular basis because more people are turning to homeschooling, and they see the value in that. Some people who can't do the homeschooling because they work, they're having homeschooling collectives where they're doing things on Saturdays. We have the sister and NG Dekar Karmo with her Baba Hudie Suya Pan-African online co-op classes where people are dealing with that, as well as Mama Mawusi Ashakir, who has the Kokonai Afurakani, Afurakani, or Afrocentric homeschooling network. So there are different institutions like that. We already have an institution, which is Akongwa Suya. What we're just doing is raising funds to establish a physical space headquarters in the DC region for the institution. This particular institution deals with three different segments. On one hand, we're dealing with classes dealing with ancestral culture, ancestral religion, institutionalizing our values, ritual practices, and so forth. We also have training, whether it's Oberima Afuraitkaitnit manhood. We'll also have the Afuraitkaitnit womanhood training based on the publications, overcoming transcarnational trauma, overcoming, you know, substance abuse, addictions, and so forth from an African ancestral religious perspective. The different trainings, the trainings for the social workers and human services agents on how to incorporate culture in their therapeutic interventions with their clients, the Sankofa Jumapi. And then we also have the other component, which is the publishing component, dealing with, we already published our book, but we're doing that in our residence. We'll just have the publishing arm in the physical space, and we'll expand it. So there'll be employment opportunities with respect, since we do all of our printing and cutting and shipping and everything else in-house, and we'll have employment opportunities for people who will engage the ship printing process and going through the whole printing process, as well as the packaging and shipping and orders and everything else. So we have those three different segments that will be in, you know, in the institution, housed in the institution. But as far as the teaching element, we are reinforcing ancestral religion and culture in what we're doing. Eventually, of course, we will have a homeschooling, homeschooling resources in the institution. That'll be part of it. And, of course, eventually we will have an institution, K through 12, rooted in Akan culture. And then, of course, other Afurakani, Afuraitkaitnit, you know, children, of course, that come as well, and we will accommodate them. So when we're talking about Akan culture, we'll also show the correspondences based on who they are as well, so they will know. So eventually, just like you have churches who have churches, but then they also have their own school, and it's K through 12. You have Muslims who have, you know, mosques, but then they also have a school, K through 12, and some of them eventually have a college or university. People who practice ancestral religion who are focused, they end up doing the same thing as well. You have a couple of groups, like in Philly, they have Egbe Hijoba, the Yoruba community, but then they also have a school. In D.C., Nation House Positive Action Center, they deal to a certain extent with the Akan ancestral religion to a certain extent, but then they also have an independent school, you know, a basic Pan-African type school. And anybody who's involved in ancestral religion in the real sense, as they establish institutions, as they establish and begin to teach and organize, quite naturally what unfolds out of that is the establishment of preschool, K through 12, and eventually universities, just like everybody else does. It's just natural for us to move in that direction. So when people coalesce and, you know, connect and they recognize the value of the culture, then they automatically, the people who have those skills, they organize and they establish those, you know, institutions within the institution. But starting out, we're going to deal with the institution we already have. We're just going to house it in a space. And that deals with, on one hand, culture, including ritual, ancestral religion, classes dealing with that, also dealing with training, the various trainings we talked about, and then the publishing business arm, where we will be able to employ people as well and, you know, expand our publication. We have 16 books out now. We have more books coming out. So this is what we're dealing with right now. But eventually it will, in addition to that, we will have K through 12, and eventually we will have a university, a full-fledged university rooted in our ancestral culture.
All right. Excellent for answering that. And my last question, in regards to Monday, you did a brief broadcast on the effects of marijuana and alcohol and stuff. But one thing I don't find understanding is, what is the significance of most of people partaking in this particular date? They have to get severely high. I don't understand where they got it from, or the root word of this number 420. I'm not sure if you know the answer to this question.
Right. So people who are drug addicts who smoke marijuana, 420 is the little date that they, some of them come together all around the country, and they put it like their little drug addict holiday. And brainwashed Negroes follow along with that. And we put a post up mentioning that people who claim to be Afrocentric, African-centered, culturally grounded, and so forth, not only are they poisoning themselves, poisoning their melanin, making themselves susceptible to and receptive to this kind of perverse spirits. When you open up your pores, you're in your aura, and you're not able to sanction all of the thoughts and ideas that are flowing in because you're high, then things enter into your system and your mindset that normally you would repel. You're weakening your spiritual immunity. Not only are you doing that, which is anti Afrocentric, anti Afurakani, anti Afuraitkaitnit, supporting the plans of chemical and biological warfare of the whites and their offspring against our community. Not only are you doing that, but also claiming to be Afrocentric, African centered, and you say, well, Jesus doesn't exist, I don't celebrate Christmas, Thanksgiving is about thanksgiving, and the whites and their offspring enslaving and murdering our people, I don't celebrate that, and I don't celebrate any white holidays, which is good. But then you turn around and celebrate a white drug addict holiday, and that comes from some white people in the West, like in California somewhere. They decided, some cracker was deciding that around 420, that was the 420 in the afternoon, that was the best time to smoke weed, and they used to gather together and smoke weed. And then they started expanding it And then the next thing you know, they created this little day where everybody on 420, April 20th, that was like the drug addict holiday. So brainwashed Negroes who think that they're Afrocentric, claiming to not celebrate white holidays, they reject all the other white holidays, but then they follow drug addict white dissexuals on 420 so that they can drug themselves based on a white holiday. That just shows the pathology of our people, shows how insane our people are, how corrupted the minds of our people are, where on one hand they're so discordant that they claim to be one thing, but on the other hand they're doing the exact opposite. And it just demonstrates how corrupted and distorted their minds are. When we talk about marijuana widens the synaptic cleft in the brain, which is the space between the neurons, so the transmission, electric transmissions going from one neuron to the next, traveling so you can think and process information. If the cleft widens, it has to jump over a wider cleft or a cliff to get to the next neuron, and it takes longer to get there, so you're more hazy when you're thinking. This is what's happening. And this is just a manifestation that this discordant, this so-called cognitive dissonance, where they claim one thing and practicing something else, this is just a manifestation of being an addict, a drug addict. So that's what it is.
Okay. Well, thank you for answering my question. To next time, Quasira, the doctor. Appreciate it.
Okay, maybe I'll say that. We appreciate the call. All right, so that was all of the different, that was all the calls we have. So it's about 11:27, so we're going to end here. Yedase, we thank you for tuning in to the show. Again, our next broadcast is next Drawdown Monday. This is the 13th, this week, coming up minute out Saturday, is the 13th anniversary of the KUKUU-TUNTUM. One of the things that we did is we put a button on the page, on the KUKUU-TUNTUM page, 50% off. It was a special 13th anniversary price. We ordered 10 copies of the KUKUU-TUNTUM. On one hand, people were starting study groups. Ordering 10 copies of the KUKUU-TUNTUM is 50% off, so it's basically $5 per book instead of $10 per book. So that was like a special 13th anniversary price for the KUKUU-TUNTUM, and that'll be going on until Saturday. After that, it goes back to the regular price for 10 books, the 30% off for 10 books, but up until Saturday, it'll be 50% off. So some people who are forming Nanasom Fetku or Nanasom Ancestral Religious Study Groups, and we talked about that. We did a broadcast about that. You can simply, you, one or more people, you can get together and begin studying together once a week or once every other week. The first book in the curriculum is KUKUU-TUNTUM, The Ancestral Jurisdiction. So you just go through the information, make sure everybody understands and is clear on the information. You can just go through the entire book. So we have a curriculum for Nanasom Fekhu. Some people who have been forming those groups, they ordered the 10 books, but then some people, even if you're not forming a group, you can order the 10 books at 50% off, and then you can sell them to friends, family, coworkers, and so forth. And you make your money back. So you purchase them for $5 each and you sell them for 10, so you make $5 per book. And typically when somebody sees the book, if you are at work or on the train or, you know, somewhere and somebody sees the book and they see on the front cover it says Jesus never existed, Muhammad never existed, Moses never existed, and so forth, and they see some images, they'll just ask you, what are you reading? The book will sell itself. And if you say, well, I actually have some, they're only $10, they'll give you a $10 bill just to see what's in that book, to see what you're talking about. So some people can use that sale as a way to generate income for yourself. So you can go to the KUKUU-TUNTUM page on our website or the Nhoma page, the publications page, and you'll see the button that says KUKUU-TUNTUM 13th anniversary 50% discount, and that's simply purchasing 10 books for 50% off. So you can utilize it as a way to generate income for yourself. And that's part of our institution as well. We have the Kwadefo entrepreneurship piece, distributor piece, where people who would like to be distributors of all of our books, you can purchase them wholesale and then sell them retail. So we already have that program going. this is just a extra thing. If you would like to sell the KUKUU-TUNTUM since it's the anniversary, you can buy 10 of them for 50% off. And yada say to the individuals who have purchased the 10 copies and distributed them and starting the groups, we appreciate that. And again, for those who would like to support the work that we are doing so we can continue to publish works like the KUKUU-TUNTUM and more, you can go to our Homa page, the publications page, make a purchase of one or more of our soft cover books, or make a donation, any donation, again, of $15 or more. You will receive one or more of our books in return for your donation. Just remember to mention which book in the comment section when you make the donation. Write out which books, the titles of which book or books you would like to receive in return for your donation. So, Yedase, we thank you for tuning in. And again, Yebeshia Bio, we will meet again. That's all.